Hello everybody, good afternoon. This session will not be a one-sided kind of talk. It's not just for me to give a lecture and go away, but because your management has requested me to give you some online tools, I request all of you to keep yourself unmuted whenever required and also to be participative in the whole of the session. Is that okay with all of you?
Okay.
Right, thank you. And before we formally start our session, let me thank Manu University and Professor Farida and Mr. Abdul Taha, Dr. Abdul Taha, who have been in touch with me and constantly updating me about the training program. Thank you so much for choosing me to be part of this training session. To begin with, let's check ourselves what exactly we can do for today. Yeah, the topic that we're going to deal with today is technology for teaching and assessment. And this is for I-generation learners. Maybe I stands for intelligence. That is how we understand them now. The learners that we have in our classes today are not the learners like we were when we were in the classes before. I'm very sure you also agree with me when I say these are the learners who wanted to learn things faster and they have lesser patience than our generations have in learning particularly. They don't want to spend long hours sitting at one place and doing the same thing, that is listening to somebody. So in that context, the present teaching learning system has changed a lot. And that change was something just before 2020 February. And after that, that is with pandemic spreading across the world and COVID-19 being the major threat of the century, it's not a small thing that we are facing. There are lots of changes and particularly communication across, and particularly in education sector, has changed tremendously. The skills that were appreciated before 2020 are not the skills now being very much appreciated. A person who is very fluent in the subject and is able to deliver the talk with a lot of organization and clarity, is not what is required now today. How much I'm able to talk with grip on the concept that I would like to deliver is not what is required for people now, because much well-known bigger professors, big in name, I mean, are available online to everybody. What is required now by a teacher is just to guide them, reach the right resource and get the right thing from the resources provided. So the teacher is no longer a teacher, a teacher is no longer a lecturer, a teacher is no longer even a mentor, to its sense. It's not just being a facilitator, a guide who can guide the learners, take them to the resources that are available, the appropriate resources and the appropriate manner of learning. That is all is required by the teacher today. And for that, any teaching learning session that the teacher is getting prepared with or is getting ready for is much beyond preparation by reading a text or reading the related text to expand the idea given by a text. So we are required to assimilate a lot of knowledge available online, put everything in a very compact manner in our slides or in the videos that we prepared, and in total check out for how learners are journey traveling along with us in the journey of search for knowledge and in the journey of acquiring skills required for the profession. And that is where we are all stuck. We really do not know how we are going to move forward. And most of the times we are also left blank. We really do not know how our learners are going to respond to us, how much they're learning from us, how much is left just in air like that. And in the fix, in the total confusion, the whole world is, and particularly the education departments are. We are now trying to explore different ways, trying to look at various ways of reaching to our students. And on top of everything, we are also struggling to manage, become technocrats, become tech savvies, learn lots of online tools and reach our students in an appropriate manner so that we ensure some time is utilized positively in the whole span of period of time that we are sitting in front of the system. So as I was telling you, I don't want to give this long lectures. All of us know this tragic fable of pandemic. So let's look at what we can now do with the present situation. Are you all logged into your systems, or do you have mobiles as well with you? Or you have logged into your mobiles? What is the status? May I know?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. We have our mobiles.
You have your mobiles with you. So is it beside you? You have your mobiles? Right. Anyway, let me share this link in the chat box. You can very simply enter menti.com. Go for only menti.com, menti.com, and enter this. As soon as you enter this menti.com, you get this link. You get this box which asks for code. So in the code, you can enter 84, 48, 81, and 9.
Ma'am, it's not asking for any code. It's just asking for the tools I'm familiar with.
No, you must have gone into okay. Did you click on the link? If you click on the link, you will be directly
be yes, taken ma'am.
into the question itself.
Yes, ma'am.
If you did not click on the link, you can go for menti.com and enter this code, so that it'll be more convenient for you. You can check it out both ways. You can just click on the link, which is easier for all of you, or else you can also do this. 84, 48. Oh, did I come out of my presentation? Not really. Okay, it is 84, 48, 81, and 9. You can just go into menti.com if you're not on the same screen. This is an option that you have. Menti.com and give the code when it asks. Otherwise, you can very conveniently log into the same page and by clicking the link that I have given in the chat box. That is a convenient option for you. Okay, are you all onto the Mentimeter page?
Are yes, you, yes, madam.
Yes, ma'am.
Are you answering it? Wow, that's yes, great. So
let's
check how many have answered already, and let's see what the responses are now.
Ma'am, here tools mean apps or the devices or platforms?
Tools are apps. Apps.
Apps.
Applications. Any of the applications you're familiar with.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, my screen also tells me how many of you have responded to it already. My screen also tells me what your responses are. So I'm sharing the screen with all of you.
Yes, ma'am, we can see your screen.
That's great. So most of you are familiar with Google Classroom.
Yes, ma'am.
Some of you are with Blackboard. Okay, some of you are familiar with Google Meet, Kahoot, Socrative. Great. Zoom, Jamboard. Wow. So it's WebEx. Byju's, Moodle. Wow. That's great. Microsoft Teams, that's great. That's beautiful. Okay, I think this exercise is enough. I didn't get many responses, however. Great. Now, what we're going to do today is what I'll be sharing it from here now. I'm sure any of these tools are not common kind of tools that all of you are familiar with. So in that context, let's go check with some few things that we're going to do today. What I planned when I was asked for the session is to do these. Talk about two virtual classrooms. One is a Google Classroom and one is Microsoft Teams. Teams used as Classroom. We call them as learning management system. Learning management system is a platform where we can use number of other tools. You have the whole of your class lesson plan put together at one place. And that is what we call as learning management system. Now, Google is a sort of learning management system. Google Classroom is not a complete one that way. And similarly is Teams Classroom. For example, if you go to something like Moodle, Moodle is a complete learning management system where the whole of the lesson can be planned online and you can execute everything there. However, nothing is for free there. Version is very limited and you will have to really buy lots of tools, update yourself and keep using it. The second I thought of sharing with you are related to the presentation tools. How on your basic, what we thought is just a slide, your PowerPoint presentation has number of other things to be added, to be included in our classroom. And that is a PPT with all the add-ons that it has as a facility. We also will be looking at Prezi and the interactive presentation tools like Zeetings and Nearpod. The next one is classroom discussion tools, how we can make the classroom very active. In the sense, we participate, we pose a question to the class and the whole class responds to it. The class also will be giving you an interactive kind of atmosphere where one student can post something responding to the same students, another student can respond, and everybody sees what one is doing in the class. So that kind of classroom discussion tools, one we have already visited is Mentimeter, and we'll also be looking at others and how do we use them in the classroom, creating them as classroom tools is what we'll be looking at. The next last ones are Quizlet and Google Forms and TED-Ed and such kind of assessment tools. What exactly will we be doing with the assessment tools and how do we generate some kind of quiz or assessment for learning? How do we check with our learners is what we'll be looking at. I know the time that we have is very less. And within this short time, I also know it is very ambitious to look at so many tools. So what all I can do is only to show you how exactly we can really go about with this training session. So virtual classrooms in general is asking for a paradigm shift from us. All of us have this problem of shifting from a synchronous classroom where we have one time. Chron is related to time and synchrony is single time. So if it is a single time kind of one, the teacher goes, delivers a talk or gives a class to everyone. That is something which a teacher can do from her side. And that is a regular classroom that we are all used to. However, when it comes to asynchronous classrooms, this is what we are now trying to get into use now. What we are trying to do is to share our classes as videos to our students. And these videos are once again given access to wherever we upload our videos. And the learners can conveniently download them or watch them online and come back to the class prepared. This is what we call as asynchronous classes. We give only the sources. We give some kind of assignments. We ensure that the learners have visited these sources and we ensure that they understood something from what we try to give them as a source. So it can be videos that a teacher prepares. It can be videos that already exist on a particular topic. It can be assignments. It can be reading texts. It can be exercises that reinforce the knowledge that is given. And many other aspects of it can be done in the absence of a normal classroom individually by the learners. So such kind of classes are called asynchronous classes. We miss the physical monitoring every time. Say somebody is not with us. Hello, where are you looking? Are you with me? Come on, let's do this. Kind of facility you have when you are in a conventional classroom. But now only the picture of everyone is shown on the screen. So I don't know where you're looking. I don't know whether you're with me. I don't know whether you're sleeping and waking up. I don't know whether you're cooking. I don't know whether you're feeding your children. What exactly is happening behind the screen that is shown to me? Am I speaking to humans? Sometimes you get frustrated because all that you can see is only your face where the camera is on. The rest of the cameras are off. So you don't know who your learners are. Who is sitting in front of the system? Is it the student or the student's mother? You don't know who is answering your assignments. Is it the student or the student's brother or father? We are totally gone. We are at loss. And finally, how do you conclude that it is a student who has learned what is supposed to be learned? No evidences. For that, once again, we need to depend on technology. You need to have a lot of proctoring system. For that, are we all ready for it? Do we know all that? These are the questions that come back to us every day. And it is really, really a very disappointing kind of day as teachers for all of us. And that's why it is very difficult to monitor learning, to ensure learning outcomes, to have any kind of positive engagement with the learners, or the learners getting positively engaged with learning. All this is a great challenge that we have today. Now, anyway, but we are not the people who are going to leave there. We have our own choices to, when I make it a full screen, the problem is that I'll not be able to shift immediately. And that's why. Fine. I think this should be okay with you.
Thank you, ma'am.
No, I have a problem when I make it a full screen. That is why I tried not to do it. However, with all the problems that we have, we still see some kind of advantages of going online. And the advantages are here. One is all the tools that we are using are very user-friendly. It's not very difficult, unlike before, like say in 1980s, accessing or having access to computer was a big thing. One, it was not very easily available in the market. Two, it is very expensive. Three, the language that computer understood is not the language that we used. So we had to learn a separate language. There were programming languages. We had to learn the programming languages and access the computer. We need to give the orders in a particular manner. There are commands, and the structure of the commands are to be learned and used only in that way. A space or a comma or a full stop means something else to the computer, so we did not know all those. Now, technology is like you give a command, the artificial intelligence is working a lot. Now, you orally give a command and it's doing things for you. Now we know Alexa doing it. We know an iPhone, Siri doing a lot of things for us like that. Lots of Bluetooth technologies, even without the wireless technology that has come, even without getting connected to anything with Bluetooth and with Wi-Fi, we are able to connect things a lot and working now. So this is giving scope for us to have synchronous, asynchronous classes. Now, today in the afternoon, I'm not really ready to listen to the class. So let me take some break and listen to it in the evening. I have a choice. And that is an advantage of having asynchronous classes. And these are also more engaging otherwise. It's not like teacher giving a task and engaging. It is like I open the link given by the teacher, and I have a whole lot of things to be done, and I'm engaged in that kind of learning. Apart from, okay, some less motivated students bringing in their parents or siblings to do the job. Apart from that, which is always a risk that online has, but still we have lots of advantages in using online teaching. Now, previously it is like constantly listening to the same voice talking and telling things, but now you have number of other sources that the teacher cannot compensate or compete even with. Say today, if I talk about language methods, I might be a very tiny dot in the ocean of knowledge that methods have, and stalwarts and big people are accessible online. They started talking about giving free online education resources, OERs, we call them. Everywhere they are available, and it's a whole new world open to the learners. And inclusive education is there. It is very personalized. You can it is easily accessible to everyone. It's more relevant to the students' needs now. We can convert our classes to, okay, we can give the assignments to individual students, we can give the assignments to groups of students, we can give the assignments to the whole class at a time and get the responses. All these choices were less available and less used by the teachers before. And it boosts up the students' creativity as well. We can have variety of answers, unlike before where we expected only one kind of answer from everyone. So with all this, our online teaching is also very positive. And there are no issues of corporal punishments now. Now you are not very comfortable, you cannot take the freedom of beating something. And if at all you want to show your anger, it is only your screen. So you will have to spoil your gadget, which is your life now. So that's how things are. We are moving ahead.
Excuse me, ma'am. Ma'am, yes? Before you proceed to the other slide, may I ask you a question?
Please.
You've written inclusive there. What does inclusion imply here?
Inclusive in the sense all kinds of learners are part of our classes. Inclusive education is like previously we all used to assume that learners are all at one pace, one level, and we used to deliver our classes in that sense. But now we can include learners of different abilities, one, of different heterogeneity, two, and of different, I also mean to say of different cultures. Okay, if you, the class can be catering to the needs of all the learners with all their different abilities. That is what I mean by inclusive. Okay. We also have in BEd now a particular paper called Inclusive Education, where the teachers are trained, or that particular course is meant for teachers to understand that learners come with different disabilities into the classroom. And if there is a learner of some kind of different ability, that learner also has to be taken into consideration, particularly even in the form of assignments that you give, any assessment that you make, and even every building is supposed to be inspected that way. Every educational institution is supposed to be inspected that way. Do they have special ways of reaching the disabled students into the classroom? So buildings are supposed to have some railing, which is not steps, which might stop disabled students to come into the class as regular students do, or regular humans do. So that is what is by inclusive. Maybe too long an answer for you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was clear. Thank you.
Right. So we have another activity to do here because I would like to understand you more. So let's go into this particular task.
Oh.
I'm posting it here. Please click on the link. This will take you to a different page. I think my camera conked off and you will not be able to see me hereafter. Yeah, did you get to this page, which is called Best Use of Technology in the Classroom?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Now, your question is, technology for teaching, what do you think is the best use of technology in the classroom? How best can you really use technology in your classroom? Okay. I shall repeat, you are supposed to mention what do you think is the best thing that technology has done to your classroom. You just need to go to the right bottom extreme. You have a plus symbol. You click on that, you get your own page, own box is opened, and you can start typing your answer there. You can also mention your name on the top, because the minute you open the box, it says title. As title, you can give your name, and below the box, you can type your answer. And finally, if you click anywhere outside the box where you're typing, it presents your answer as a completed one. Are you all with me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, there are 7 responses till now, which only says yes. About good. If you want to make any changes to the previous answer that you posted as yes or hi or something, you can go to the same box and click it once again. You'll be able to make change in the same, which means you can edit your answer. Wow, beautiful answers I've received here. So let me start with somebody who says it saves time in learning, not teaching, definitely. And builds 21st century skills, increases student engagement and motivation, and accelerates learning. And Taranum Khan says it can be used as discussion forum. And Nagaraju says it makes students learn the subject effectively and conveniently. Sabha Khatun says technology made our classroom and teaching learning more attractive and flexible. Mohammed Kaja says he has a long answer. He says first thing technology has is that it brings students and teacher on one platform. Were we not there in a classroom on one platform? Let's look at it. Online mode of learning is one of the best ways to connect from anywhere, from remote area, and start learning students. Okay. And who else? Easily able to communicate with students. And Syed Hajera says, when we were not provided with projectors, we have to show practicals to students by showing them the computer screen. By the limit was 10 students at a time, but now we are provided with a projector so we can show practicals very easily and conveniently. Okay, that's great. Good kind of experience all of you have. In my history class, the best technology for teaching in the classroom is a projector where I show them architectural and archaeological sites, maps, paintings, movies, and other clips to engage in learning. That's great. I utilize it for various resources while teaching. That's great. Easy to use various tools in teaching and learning. It gives clarity to various concepts. It saves time, it saves cost, and it is cost effective both for teachers and students. Is it cost effective? That we need to check. It saves time. I understand you're trying to use your screen writing. If you can avoid that, it'll be great. Right. And with your experiences as teachers, this is really appreciable to see that, okay, all of you have had very positive kind of experience towards using technology in the classroom. That's great. So getting back to our screen, now let's look at how comfortable all of you are using Google Classroom. Shall we have poll here? Okay. Now, is my screen visible to all of you? Not really, right? Okay. I'll do this. Now we are going to learn one tool, which is an add-on to our own PPTs. I am not very sure how many of you are familiar with use PPT other than for making a presentation, or do you have any other ways of doing your PowerPoint presentations? How do I know your answer? Okay, you can just post it in the chat box. Is my screen visible to all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
So you have seen how I went to this poll everywhere. Now, I have got into this format. In the format, there is something called as add-ins. Add-in is to bring in other kind of add-on tools to PowerPoint itself. So when you click on add-in, I have already added two particular tools or apps that can be used within PowerPoint presentation. So what did I do? I clicked on that, and the existing my two tools are, one is Poll Everywhere and the second one is Easy Timer. We'll discuss how Easy Timer can be used later, but as of now, I'm using Poll Everywhere. So Poll Everywhere can be part of our presentation itself. You can just download it on your PowerPoint. Your regular PPT, you can open, click on this add-ins and get Poll Everywhere. However, Poll Everywhere has a very, very small limit when it comes to using it for free. That is, it has only 25 as a limit. Are you all able to see this?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, what you're supposed to do now is to log into poll.ev, poll.ev.com/SuvarnaLakshmi123. I'll post it now. Let me show it to you. You need to log into that and later give the code here.
Hi, good afternoon, ma'am. I would appreciate if you could type in chat box
I did.
Right, yeah.
I did leave that in the chat box.
That's
good. Okay.
Thank you. We didn't see yet.
We haven't received it yet, ma'am.
Okay.
Better to share your screen if possible.
Yeah, I'm doing it.
Yeah. Or even the chat box. Chat box will be the best. From there, we can directly click or we can.
Yeah, is it visible now? I don't know if this
Yes,
is.
Ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Please share the link in the chat box, ma'am.
I did. So as we use the tools, one of the purposes is also to check how easy it is to use them with the regular kind of apps or applications that we generally use in our classrooms. So PowerPoint is something which we are all used to for the past 20 years or so. But something which is advanced now is to go with PowerPoint in different ways. It's not just the regular slide that we are showing, but we can use the same PowerPoint for number of other purposes. So till now I got only 4 people, 5, 6, 7 who responded to this. Wow, that's good. That's great.
Right, I can.
Okay, good. So shall we close this now? Can we move on to the next slide?
Ma'am, we can use this for MCQs as well, like a sudden question.
Yes.
2 or 4 options.
You can use it for various questions. Let me tell you the patterns of questions that this has, but Poll Everywhere primarily can be used for polling. You can give options to the students, and as the title itself says, it is Poll Everywhere. You can generally give it as multiple choice questions or for opinions. Primarily, it is used for this purpose. Okay, I'll also give you other tools that can accept number of other ways of receiving responses from your learners.
So, ma'am, does PowerPoint presentation, this Microsoft PPT app has this poll EV embedded in it? Or do we
have to? You have to add in. Click on add in, which is on the top of your slide. And you click on add-ins, you get number of add-ins. I'll show you how many add-ins you have, which are part of the store, your Microsoft store itself. So Picket is for other, you always get frustrated regularly looking at the slide design. So if you want to have other slide designs, you want to include some kind of licensed photographs, you can use Picket. So you also have web viewer. So suddenly while teaching something, you feel that, okay, you can show another kind of web page. So you can use that web viewer. And you want to use some emojis as part of your presentation. So you can use emoji keyboard. Similarly, like this is what emoji keyboard shows. So so you have number of things in the store. You just have to download them. And when you download, it doesn't show you anywhere except in your PowerPoint itself. So most of these are free ones, and you can use them very conveniently within your presentation. And you can embed them in your presentation, which is very easy for you to use while you are teaching a class. Okay, so these are the number of tools. I used only two, so only two are shown in mine. So I use this easy timer. I give a quiz or question on my slide and ask the students to respond within this time for this particular task. So easy timer is something of that sort. It is very easy, and it will also give the teacher and students an alarm after the task is over. Okay, it says the time is up and so you need to move ahead. It alerts both the teachers and students. That is a positive thing about these add-ins. You can very comfortably use it. Another major kind of one which I regularly use is this Office Mix. This is another plugin that can be used with PowerPoint presentation. Office Mix has something like you can record your slides, you can screen a recording, you can preview the same, you can upload the whole of your recordings as a video on YouTube. Or you can also upload it on Microsoft PPT itself. You can upload it in SlideShare. That becomes an open kind of one. You can add your audio, you can add video. And finally, you can share it as, even without any of these, you can generally share your, you can start video recording your slide, make it an asynchronous kind of classroom tool or classroom resource, and very conveniently share it with your students. And when you make this, you also have an option of reducing the file size and saving it, so that you can make it as lesser kind of pixel. You can store it as a smaller file which comes to below 50 MB. And you can conveniently share it with your students even on WhatsApp and so on, or on your Google sites. This is a convenient way of using your Google ones. Now let's go into G Classroom and look at how G Classroom is also useful. Now in my using my Office Mix, I have included a video here. Not very sure if it plays very conveniently, if I'm not showing it. Yeah. By the way, is my audio and video visible to all of you?
Ma'am, audio was not.
Only we can see the video, not the audio.
Okay. Audio is not there for you. I'm sorry, which means my audio, which I'm using for the meeting, has to be clicked off, switched off, and then the audio on the screen will be
while
visible.
Selecting, you have to select, I think.
Yes, I need to. I need to mute myself, and then we should go for it.
And is it possible to enlarge this video screen on the slide, ma'am?
I think I'm sure ma'am could do that by just enlarging the size of her video. We all could see. We may not read the sentences, but we could see the video. But even if you keep like this, that's okay for us. If you could listen the sound. Oh yeah, that's perfect, ma'am.
Okay, once I mute myself, my video must have had its audio. Did you get that?
No, ma'am. It not wasn't really. Audible. Okay.
There are some settings that I need to change, but not to worry. I just wanted to show this as an example.
Yes,
so
perfect.
So you can incorporate audio files, you can incorporate videos, and you also can incorporate any of the other web pages or web tools on the PPT itself to bring everything at one place. Okay, that's a way you can really use PPT. It is not confined just to showing slides which are not interactive that ways. So you can make your PowerPoints also very interactive and make it very, very useful for designing your classes in number of ways. Now I'm moving on to the classroom that is possible for us to make.
Excuse me, ma'am. I have another question, because I find this add-ins very interesting, because that would keep my students alert, active, and responsible.
Yeah.
Does the add-in poll Evie give a report to the teacher who participated, how many participated?
Yeah. It is very clearly shown on the slide itself. So I'm able to see, if you can, are you able to see my slide here?
I can see total results, but can we see the names total also?
No, not really the names. If you download the results, the downloading of the results is possible only on a paid version. And the total number along with the options that are given, the division or the percentages of each option will be also sent to your mail ID. So as you register for it, you need to download here as plugin. You need to give your email ID and password. And as you finish registering, that gives a link to your mail also. So your mail, in your mailbox, you will immediately receive the results. I'll also show you that. If I have... Received it already. I need to close, by the way. My poll should be stopped here. Say lock the responses. Then I get these responses as a mail to my mailbox. This is how it is. It'll take a couple of minutes. So let's not wait for it. By the time we receive the poll everywhere result. I'm sure all of you know that, okay, the Google Apps are part of your Google Mail. And if you go to your Drive and start accessing your classroom, it's easier for you. You can say classroom, and you get your classroom here, Google Classroom. And as part of the classroom itself, you have a number of other apps that are available. All these apps can be something which are very free to use and very convenient for us to attach to our mails. We don't need to really store them anywhere. All the information that you have there is available everywhere. So for example, if I have a class here, the class is already there. So I display the class code. Is the class code visible to all of you?
We can see your PPT, ma'am, not Google Classroom page.
Okay, so, right. So I'll start sharing my screen once again. Yes, can you see the Google class code here?
Yes, ma'am.
KFQPE56. Yes. So please enter Google Classroom code and enter my class. Okay. As you enter the Google Classroom, these are the things. Here you can have the class details. I can give the name of the class. I can give the description of the class. Which room are we meeting? Is it a virtual room, or what kind of a subject are we meeting for? And in the general, you also have options here. Would you like to invite anybody, everybody, or do you have some specificities? Like say, for example, if you want to invite everybody only by the Google code, this is a code, invite through classroom code, and display the code, you can do that. Now on the main page, if you look at my main page here, there are people who entered and started making lots of comments on different things. So if I don't like that, I can also restrict my class from making such kind of comments. Say the mainstream students can post and comment. I can change this option and say only teachers can post or comment, which means the main class can have teachers instructions or anything that the teacher wants to make as an announcement. Anything that the teacher wants to make as an announcement to my class. So once I finish that, if I save, now none of you can post on the main page. It remains as a closed one for the students to comment anything. And the next one is a classroom. I know most of you have said you also have been using it regularly. You few things which I would like to bring to your one is, you have assignments, quiz assignment, question, material, reuse a post and topic. You click on the topic, you get the topic here, how to become a public speaker, that's the topic. And what do I want to use? It is also subtopic is unit 2. And based on that, I can give assignments, I can give question quiz. I also can pose assignment questions, which are something which I can predefine my classroom with the resources that I have. Now, everything I give also can be calendared. So I open my calendar and say, okay, this particular assignment should be submitted to me by this particular time. How do we do that? Let me show you. So I pose a question. Well, versed are you with Google Classroom? If I pose a question here, my answer should be short answer question, or would you like to use a multiple choice? Now I don't have multiple choice. I want to use it only this way. So I create this question. Now who should answer? Is it all the students in this class, or will I be choosing some of them to participate and use mine? I have so many students already registered for this online class. So what do? I choose only a couple of you and say, okay, this class can, or this particular assignment can go only to a few people and not to all. So I choose some of them. I delete them from responding to this assignment. So I do this. Finally, there are only a couple of students in my classroom. So for how many marks can I give this assignment? I can give it only for, say, 3 marks. So the number of points I get is only 3 if I answer this question. When is the due date? The due date to submit, I can give, say, today is 5th. So I mark it as 5th. I also can give time as 5 p.m. So on 5th at 5 p.m., this has to be answered. And this is part of how to become a public speaker. Part of that lesson, I'm giving this particular task. So something which is very convenient with Google Classroom is your choice of marks and also the questions that you give as assignments. And you can also decide when you can read give it to them. You can also decide when they should answer to you by what time. So that is something which you can go ahead. You can share this as a Google document. What is Google Doc? You can write a question here, the same question here, and then say share. How many of the Google apps I pose this question, please mention the apps here. And I say share. How do I share it? I save first. And so I share it with all the teachers online. No, this can be only viewer. And change to anyone with the link. Now, who will get my link? My link will be given only to my students. So I'll share my link with my students and I say Fine, share. So it goes to all the students and they will be able to edit and come back to you saying once again, it gets opened only as a Google document and the same will be shared with all of you. Now you can also see others' responses to the same document when about 40 to 50 students are given the same document and shared, their responses also will be clearly shown to you as a shared document. So this is an advantage we have. We can see this is a warning to our learners also. Like they can't write whatever they like. No rubbish can be shown because they also feel ashamed that, okay, their quality of response is so low. And hence they'll put in their effort to respond appropriately to the questions or the tasks that are given. So that is how we can have a tab on the learner's progress that ways. Another thing that we can do is to move on. Check with the people who are already there. And we also can check with the grades. Once the assignment or the quiz that you create has some points and you mark that point and give it to the responder, it immediately forms into a grid and shows you how many have done the assignment, how many have not done the assignment, what mark you have given, or automatically if it is a quiz, the mark is automatically registered here. So how would you like to do it and what is a form that you would like to give is something which you can, everything is predefined, predetermined kind of one. For example, you also can have another choice. What I can do is to prepare a Google form. Say in the drive, I say, I have a Google form. Okay, there is an untitled form. So I say quiz for the class. The same you can give as quiz for the class. In the settings, you can go to quizzes. So you go for quizzes and you make this as a quiz. Okay, so you go to the quiz, you ask for the email ID, and you start giving number of questions here. When you say send, you get a link that can be shared with your classroom, or you also can, as you have all your students' email IDs with you, you also can mail it to them. Now, when you share this particular link with your students, you can very conveniently go to your classes, include all your students' email IDs and say quiz. And you also can schedule your quiz in the sense, even if you do not do in your class itself, in your Google class, you can schedule the link to be activated at a particular time. In that ways, you also can schedule your mail to be sent at a particular time. Okay, say if I want to say, okay, if I say this and a couple of others, I can use this and I can also use this. Couple of students I choose to send my mail, I can schedule it and say this particular mail can be sent not today, but on Monday. And on Monday, what time can it be released? I can give this mail Monday 9 a.m. So schedule send. if I say this, it is already scheduled. Now, whether you open your mailbox on that particular point, at that particular point of time or not, you surely will have your mail sent then. So by 9 o'clock, the mail will be in the mailboxes of the recipients. Now, I suddenly realize I did a mistake with that scheduled mail. I don't want it to be sent to these people. I also can say cancel send. I can now edit the whole of the mail and send it to others or cancel it anyway. So this is something which we have as a convenience for scheduling our mails. You can do it before you. Many a time we also have this idea. Okay, I need to remember sending a mail to somebody at this time. So even if you forget that, you can compose your mail and schedule it to be sent at that time. This is a convenience you have even with your mails. And whatever you want to intimate or bring it to the notice of your students, you can schedule it on your Google Classroom. You can schedule it on your Google Forms. You can schedule it even in your mails. So this is how Google Classroom in general has lots of facilities. In addition, let me show you some more apps. Yeah, something which is very interesting about Google Apps is this. You have Jamboard here. Okay, Jamboard can be used. Is my Jamboard seen by all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, right, so. Great. So when I say, when I have a Jamboard, what I can do is to own by anyone. Now I can create a new jam. The jam can talk about pictures of online classes. Okay, I want all of you to respond to this by sharing the pictures of your online classrooms, if at all you have any. So what do? I will share it with people by copying the link here. So the link is copied and I paste it in the chat box. What you can do is to pick up any kind of, sorry, it didn't come to everyone. Sorry. Yeah, you can click on this particular link and start going into the Jamboard. Now in the Jamboard, you have different options. You can check pen and say, okay, this is what I can write here. Or you can erase what I have written because that is not a neat handwriting of mine. Then I also can stick notes like how you have done on Padlet. Similarly, this is a note from me. I can use this and say save. Okay, or I can add an image. The facility you have here is immediately you can search image from Google net itself. So if I say online classes and search for images, you have something of this sort. Okay, I like this, so I post this on the page. Okay, so my assignment is done because I entered and I completed my sharing of the document. Are you all able to see this?
Yes, madam.
Right. So this is the facility that you have related to Jamboard. Jamboard can be something like a stick note, which I have given here. You can use the soft pen and start writing on the Jamboard. You can also use a text box and start writing there. Hello, everyone. So you can start writing there. You can use a circle and do it. You can use a picture and do it. You can use a stick note and do it. You can also select something. Okay. Now, this is about Jamboard. Jamboard can be an interesting activity as it is for Padlet. In Padlet, all of you have given different kinds of responses to my task. So let me also show you how other ways I can use Padlet for your responses. Okay, so are you able to see my Padlet again?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so each of this, what I can do to a response that I have got already from my student, I can one, edit the post, two, I can delete the post, I can transfer the post, copy the post, or expand the post. These are general things which are shown to you already. Now, below the responses, you also have a facility to give your comments as a teacher. So on the top, you have okay. Say if I click on Firdaus, I have several in the below as options given. So if I would like to comment on this, I can comment using different ways. So I would like to say this is a very, very beautiful kind of response that I have got from you. I can use an audio file. I can record my feedback and post it here for Firdaus, saying that any kind of feedback that the teacher wants to give, the teacher can give in the form of voice. So I can record my voice and give it as a feedback to my student. Okay, similarly, I can also respond to the same in a written form. Okay, that's about Padlet, and Padlet will not allow you to have more than three Padlets at a time. Let me show you my home Padlet. Because I registered for it about 4 years back, so I'm given this chance of using 10 Padlets at a time. But generally now, if you register for Padlet, you can use only 3 at a time. So I feel okay, the Padlet that I have used for this class is really useful, and I cannot use this Padlet any further. I can also export this Padlet in the form of a PDF, save it as PDF, and the PDF can again have different formats. Would you like it in the size of a letter, or A4, legal, portrait, or landscape, whatever it is? I say okay. I say A4 and portrait, and I say publish PDF. So all your responses, whoever has responded to mine, all your responses are there in the form of a PDF, and I can save it. Once I can download it and save it. And once I download and save it, I don't find any further use of that particular Padlet. I can delete it and add another Padlet to my Padlet page. Okay, this is how Padlet is used for other purposes as well. Right, with that we cleared Jamboard and Padlet. Padlet has wider kind of uses when compared to Jamboard. Jamboard is limited because on a Jamboard, in addition to your single kind of post, you cannot add other resources. But in Padlet, you can add other resources. For example, if I take you to my original okay, let me show you this. Okay, right, in this I have given number of other additions to my own postings. I gave links to different tasks that I want to give to my students. I gave video links, I gave links to tasks, other kind of embedments, web kind of links I have given, which have audios, which have videos, which also have task sheets. So this is one facility which you have with Padlet, which is not that widely used when it comes to Jamboard. Okay, that is a basic difference, but Jamboard is good enough. It also creates a lot of lots of enthusiasm in the learners, because once you ask them not to go for regular kind of typing of your answer, but whatever comes to your mind when I say, for example, if I give something like, how do you understand a creek? How do you get this word called creek? What do you understand by it? So instead of explaining that to me, if you can really share your idea in the form of a picture, that makes the whole class very interested. So that's a beautiful way of drawing the attention of your learners. Similarly, even in quizzes, you need not confine to the regular quiz form of giving a question and getting an answer. You can also draw pictures like these. Say, this picture has 21 different kinds of problems. Identify, this improves their observation skills. This is an innovative way of giving tasks to the students. So identify and mention not less than 10 particular problems that you can see in this picture. So starting from one side, window says night, and door at the back of the boy says daytime. The tree outside shows carrots hanging upside, which is generally there's carrots are roots. So the boy sitting or the man sitting in the sofa wears a chappal to one leg and a shoe to another leg. Below the wash basin, there is a cupboard which has books, generally which we don't do, and the books do not have one says novel written in one way and one says English written in another way. The fridge door is open, and within the fridge door there are broomsticks kept, which is odd. Again, June has 31 days in the calendar. The clock is in the reverse manner. It should have 12 1 2 3, but it has 12 13 14 and comes to 12, 11, 10 and comes to 1. So such kind of problems, if you give to your learners using different sources, it makes it very interesting for them to participate in the class as well. And similar kind of facilities and even more are there in Microsoft Teams. Let me also go to Microsoft Teams. If I have Teams, I can make a class only when I have set of email IDs, and you can give activities to your students. You can engage them with chats. You can have teams to collaboratively work, and anything that we are talking about as Jamboard or Padlet can happily happen as a class notebook in the class itself. So that is another facility that you have. Your assignments also can be in one place. So Microsoft Teams Classroom is much more composed and inclusive when compared to Google Classroom. Google Classroom has number of apps. However, it also gives you a facility to embed other kind of tools and apps into the classroom. But Microsoft Teams Classroom itself is a platform, which is even more complete when we can call it as an LMS in the sense, am I not sharing my screen? Are you not able to see that? Sorry. Right. I was sharing my screen of Microsoft Teams. Yeah, Teams will allow you to get into the classroom only when you have the email IDs of all your participants. If you do not have the email IDs, you cannot create a class. So when I want to create a class, I can also create an assignment, a quiz, or I can do it from the existing if I already have one. And Microsoft apps are also part of the classroom itself. Organizers, may we have muting of the phones? Okay, so Teams also has number of apps within it. One of the apps that we very frequently want to use is YouTube is part of it. So you can include number of YouTube videos. You can also use calendar. You can use Power. Power BI is for reports. And you can use Kahoot with Classroom. Couple of you have mentioned Kahoot as your one of the tools. Now, MindMeister is one. It can be used for brainstorming session. Quizlet is another, which can be used for quizzes and matching tasks kind of ones. These are very interesting one. You can use it within the classroom itself. You don't need to prepare it outside and then bring it into the classroom as a link and put it in the class assignments. Kind of additional things which we generally do in Google need not be done with Teams. So it is inbuilt. Many of the apps that are there in Microsoft Teams are inbuilt, and it makes it very convenient for us to go ahead with classes, everything having at one place. Something which I wanted to share with you is this. Let's do this small task. I know I'm running out of time. The number of tools that we have to discuss are huge. So, could you please click on this Zeetings? Wow, number of you have already answered. That's great. Okay, very few of you know about Padlet, and most of you did not know about Padlet before. That's what I understand. 20% knows and 80% of you don't know. The number of not known is increasing now. Are you able to see my screen? Do you see the results of?
No, ma'am.
No? Okay.
Yes, we could see, ma'am. 81%
don't. Yeah, great.
Yeah, we could see that.
Okay, great. Yeah, 83 of you say, 83% of you say you're not able to, you did not know about Padlet before, but now you got to know about Padlet. See, this is what we call as an interactive presentation tool. While I'm presenting, I can give this as part of my presentation itself, where immediately the participants can respond to it and I get the result here itself as soon as you click on it. And it is an interactive board in the sense, if your screen is a touch screen, you immediately click on yes or no, you touch it and you get the response here. Or if it is not the one, so then you use a cursor and click on it, you immediately get the response. So that way is what you want to say or what you want to express to the presenter, to the teacher in the classroom, that ways it is immediately shown there on the screen. So that is a positive and a very interactive tool of that sort is Zeetings. So let's move on to the second one. Which one of the following is the easiest for you to use? Is it creating a Google Classroom, Padlet, Zeetings, Mentimeter, TED-Ed? Which one is very convenient for you? So you can choose one of them. Is it done with you? Have you answered for this?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay. Then move on to the next one. Please give the details of the departments you work in.
Done, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. So, okay, most of you did not log in with your names. I only can have these. I can see 50 responses here. So when I move on to the next one, okay, most of you are very familiar with Google Classrooms and you're very less familiar with TED-Ed. Next, moving on to the last one.
Okay, 5 o'clock, the Baba ka lecture. Okay.
I can also see whether my people have given any kind of details of theirs, like their email IDs or not. I can also show everything like this. Now, this is a presentation tool which has, say, for example, if I want to add another slide to mine, I have different ways of doing it. One, I can upload my own PowerPoint presentation in the form of a PDF, or I can do it even in the form of an image. I also can use Canva Design. Canva Design is particularly for designing your PowerPoint. You can use very, very dynamic kind of PowerPoint slide designs if you go to Canva. And you can create a poll. Creating a quiz or a poll can be of 6 different types here. One, you can do it as thumbs up or thumbs down. One, you can do it as multiple choice. Then you can scale them, you can rate them, ranking 1, 2, 3, 4. Then you can text, you can write a text, or you can create a word cloud. Word cloud is something which we did as Mentimeter answer in the beginning of our session. So you can do all these, or you also can go for a create a survey. You can create a slide. You can create a YouTube video you can upload here, or you can bring in some other embedded content. Like I can give the Padlet link here and say it is an embedded content. So this way Zeetings is also a very good tool for presentation. However, one negative thing that you have in Zeetings is once I share the slide, this is an upcoming kind of tool, so it is not a completely foolproof kind of one. Once you share your Zeetings presentation, what happens is your audience can go back and forth with it, which you have to lock. You will have to do it manually. You should not allow your audience to move back and forth with your slides. Once you share the slide and you did not control it, your audience can keep moving and they're not with you. So that is a negative thing that you need to be conscious while preparing slides on Zeetings. This is one of the wonderful tools for presentation. One negative thing I should tell you about this again is when you upload any kind of PowerPoint presentation here, something which you will not be able to do is, wait a minute, sorry. If you upload any kind of PDF file as part of your presentation, you will not be able to zoom it when you show it to your audience. Are you able to see my presentation here?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. This presentation, actually, I was very excited to see that it is a very interactive presentation tool. So I used it in my previous talk for another university. And when I used it, I also had a couple of them with questions. My questions were not taken seriously because the answers were given in the next slides. That is one. And another one is, see, I think all of you can see this particular PDF file that I have incorporated in the slide. I'm not able to enlarge it. So when I present, my audience were not able to see that completely. Okay, that is a negative kind of one I experienced with Zeeting. I can't still enlarge it. It is still a small kind of font. Okay. So certain tools that we use, this is a lesson for all of us. Certain tools that we use, we also need to check back and forth and be very sure that is a fantastic tool that can be used for that particular class. Not all tools can be used for all classes. That is something which we need to realize. And when we are using these tools, we need to be very, very familiar with what can go right or wrong with that particular tool. Okay, with that, let me close my session so that we can take a couple of questions. I know my the kind of tools that I have been showing are superficial. I need to start from the beginning and tell you how to log in and use any of these tools. All the tools are open and free tools that I have shown you. I recommend strongly that none of the tools which are used for online teaching, do not go for spending your money and paying for any of the tools. Say there are educational tools that can be used for free and use only the free versions of it. Do not spend money, because today what you get for some kind of amount, tomorrow it will be free for you. But once you start registering yourself for a paid version, you will continue paying for it. So don't waste your money. And better versions of the same and better tools than what we are using today will be tomorrow. So there is no point in wasting our time and wasting our money on particularly tools which are online for today. With that, I close the session, and now I'm open for any of the questions or doubts that you have so that we clarify. For all, let me tell you another caution. What you use as your Google, log in with your Google ID or something of that sort will come in. Give a separate password to the apps, online tools and apps that you want to use, and give a separate password for your regular Gmail. Okay, what you use as your Gmail for communication, the mailbox should have a separate password, and anything that you use on the net as app or tool should have a separate password. So do not give access to every information that your Google box has when you are logging into a separate tool. Be very cautious. There are all chances that very important information of yours will be taken from your own mailboxes. So be very careful. Security is a major issue, and let's not give chance for that agony adding to our regular agonies of classroom anyways. Be conscious of it. Mentimeter, by the way, menti.com is used by the end user. And Mentimeter, if you register, mentimeter.com is for the teacher and menti.com is for the user. When you want to give a quiz, you ask them to log into menti.com. And as a teacher, you register on Mentimeter and you start preparing your quizzes. That's for Mentimeter. Padlet will allow you to have three Padlets. I already showed you how you can store the information related to one Padlet. And once you store that information, you can delete it and start afresh. You can also collaborate. Say two or three of you are very good friends. So your Padlets also, two or three put together, you get nine Padlets, which are very helpful for sharing. I wanted to show you some more, but we are running out of time, so let me close here.
Thank you, madam. On behalf of Growth Akshita Manu, our participant, and on my own behalf, extended a very hearty vote of thanks to Professor Yeshwarna Lakshmi Madam for delivering an informative and thought-provoking talk on technology for teaching and assessment of iGeneration. It was really a splendid presentation which exposed our participants to the technology for teaching assessment that we generally thought could only be done manually. We all are inspired with your great words, ma'am. Our heartfelt thanks to our great audiences as well as for active participation. I also thanks to the chair of the program, Professor Farida Siddiqui Madam, who organized the FIP program very well. Thank you, madam. Thank you once
again. Thank you all for your very active participation. That's very nice of you. I had a very good audience lot today. And thank you all and all the very best for all your future experiments with online classes. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. Ma'am, one request from our side.
Yeah.
Please. I wonder if you could have any really means user-friendly tools, like you mentioned one or two here, which people can be used for this coming generation. I would really appreciate. Or can we have in touch with you, or how could we get it to you?
Don't you think the tools that I have introduced to you are user-friendly?
No. These are the really nice. I don't say anything about this.
Okay.
More upon.
Do you want some more?
In terms of science and technology, for example, if you'd like to tell or explain a digestion.
Okay.
People means that I have two options, whether memorize students word by word or other ways to explain students word by word and step by step. And they can generate reasoning, what comes first and what comes second. Then they can keep this knowledge for longer time. So in that term, do you think today's are really great? Few of them, honestly, I never know that. I'm a science teacher. But I appreciate means if you could suggest where we can go and get few more things.
Okay. What I can suggest you to do, particularly as science teacher, is to go for TED-Ed. I'm very sure all of you know about TED Talks, right? Are you familiar with TED Talks, TED Talks?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes,
TED Talks and TEDx. And
yeah.
There are a lot of them.
Yeah. Now, there is something called as TED-ED.
I would appreciate if you could type it in chat box so that most of us can get benefited from this.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I'm asking too much.
No. That's not too much. So I'll post the TED-Ed here so that you will also be familiar with using TED-Ed as a tool. Yeah, got it. Okay, for sciences faculty members particularly, this is a tool where you can use videos, and along with the video, you can create tasks based on the video. And sciences definitely have videos on various subjects. And if it is TED-Ed, it also gives you a chance to give assignments along with the video. So that is a site that you can visit and create your lessons based on videos, which will be more useful for your audience.
Thanks a lot. I really appreciate this.
Welcome. And any more? For normal, regular brainstorming, you can also use this MindMeister. It's very easy to create. And as I was telling you in the beginning, all the tools that we have today are very user-friendly. You just need to register in that as a teacher and start making your class or assignment or task there itself and share it with your students, which is very easy for you. Or embed that as a link. Take that link, post it in your Google Classroom or Microsoft Teams Classroom, and ask the students to watch it and come back to you, or complete the task and come back to you. As I was telling you, all your assignments also can be timed. You can say, okay, the assignment starts at this time and should end by this time. So everybody needs to submit particular assignments at particular time, it is over. later submitted ones like the physical classroom, your Google Classroom or your Microsoft Classroom will not allow you to do it. That's how students also will be on their toes. They'll be more active and they'll also be more participative in your classes.
Ma'am, am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, you are. Please go ahead.
I'm very grateful for this session, ma'am. I learned a lot for new tools and techniques to use in the classroom, ma'am. There is a very question, ma'am. It's very simple. Ma'am, is there any tool, plugin, add-in that can be used with Zoom, Google Meet, Team to organize pair work, group work, task and activities?
In Zoom, you have a facility of dividing the groups into, you can make them into separate groups. So when you divide them, you say, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4 will go into a particular group, and you can create group work, group discussion groups with video conferencing. And after a while, you can ask everybody to join the regular Google or Zoom classroom and start presenting their discussions. This, you have it only in Zoom as of now, but with other online meeting tools, I'm not very sure of. Google Meet surely does not have it. Zoom has it. I don't know if GoToMeeting has, but Cisco WebEx has it.
Ma'am, will I be able to monitor them?
Yeah, you will be able to monitor. You can enter all the rooms as a host.
Okay. Thank you very much.
And something which is very, very good about YouTube now is YouTube videos are there for all the tools that are available online. You go to, you want to use a particular tool, or you need to know about a particular tool, you're not very familiar or you don't know the tools also, you click on use of teaching learning tools for a particular purpose in your classroom, like one of our friends was asking for science classroom. So similarly, if you have a very particular kind of use, you can click on that, go to YouTube, and every tool has an introductory video, how to use a particular tool. So you watch it in the video, it is screenshot, and every step that can that you have to follow to use a tool is very clearly given. You need to spend a bit more time, like watching the video simultaneously, you will also have to start doing the same steps as the video shows you. And you will become very familiar within a few minutes, I should tell you. So tools are that user friendly.
Ma'am, one more question related to Google Classroom, ma'am. I have an account I have been using for a very long time for Google Classroom. Mm-hmm. And my drive space is almost going to be full. So mm-hmm. will I be able to migrate all the data in, I mean, important data in the new email ID, ma'am?
You can download
for using it. Google Classroom.
You can download everything and shift it.
Migrating means all the students, all co-teachers, okay. All assignments, ma'am.
You can say duplicate. That is all I know. I don't know if you can migrate the whole of the data in any other ways. I only know duplication of the classes and duplication of the assignments. You can discard the previous one and duplicate everything. That is already given there. Now, if you also can archive your classes, so that space is being saved. And Google space for 100 GB is very less, I tell you. You hardly pay 130 rupees or something like that. Yeah, whole of the year. Per month it is 130, and for a whole year also it is only 1300. If you can afford, you can buy that 100 GB space on Google and you can keep storing things. Mm-hmm. That is something very positive. And if you can get it from your institution's G Suite account is boundless. It doesn't have any kind of restriction related to amount of data you can save on the space there.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. I thank Manu to have given me such a wonderful class today. Interaction in the class breathes in a lot of energy into a teacher, as you all must have experienced many times, and so is the class today. Thank you so much for being very participative.